Tom Stapleton, you all ready? All right. Call to order the regular town meeting of November 7th, 2016. Reading of the warrant first, and then we will do the Pledge of Allegiance. I, Constable Gerard S. Alterio, hereby certified that I have posted the regular town meeting warrant of November 7th on 10-22-16. Gerard S. Alterio, received by our new town clerk, Betsy Sheeran. And now, Mrs. Hall, Pledge of Allegiance.
To the flag.
United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Before we kick off the festivities, I want to read into the record the out-of-towners. Dan McGrath, Wakefield Recreation, Mark Sardella from the item, Matthew Bradley, Lynn O'Neill, Special Ed, Mike Pfeffering, Kim Smith, Superintendent of Schools, Carol Antonelli, Kathy Cheek, and Paul Revis. I think that's it. Thanks. Article 1. To see if the town will hear and accept a report on the fiscal year 2016 budget or see what the town will do about it. Mr. Mayo.
That the town vote to accept the report of the fiscal year 2016 budget.
Is there a second? Second. Mr. Mayo.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. As always, in preparing for the annual presentation of the town report, I reflect back upon where we have been and where I hope we as a community are all headed. This year, I think the key words are renewal and rebirth, specifically the rejuvenation of our commercial district. So I thought I would give a brief update on some of the projects that are being worked on by the Board of Selectmen, Finance Committee, School, and Permanent Building Committees. We are currently working with the Metropolitan Area Planning Council to develop a strategy which I hope will leverage our investment in the Albion Cultural Exchange at 911 Albion Street. This building, retained by the Board of Selectmen, is at a central location near the train and major highways and is hoped to serve as the anchor of a thriving, energetic, and engaged art community. We have a community meeting set up for this November 17th at the cafeteria here at the Galvin School, right across the hall. These planning sessions, armed with the data and strategies following the marketing assessment study presented again last week, I believe will prove to be very exciting and further prosperity in our downtown. The keys being art, culture, and commerce. We also are in the process of determining how best to resolve the ongoing issues with our public safety building in the Walton School. These facilities are being studied, and we plan to be back in the spring with some suggested solutions for the community. Collaboratively, with Recreation Director Dan McGrath and Athletic Director Brendan Kent and many of the youth sports groups, we are studying field equity, and I can see improvements on the horizon. And perhaps most excitingly, we are reviewing the feasibility of a hockey rink at the high school campus. Now, these improvements take time and careful planning, and I believe that we as a community have a very good record if you look at the recent Galvin School construction and the high school recreation facility construction. So I ask that the community be to patiently participate in the planning process with us so we can bring what I hope are first-class improvements to this town. We also continue to look at the lake cleanup, particularly evaluating emerging technologies here. This is a big issue, and we want to get it right. I will continue to work with the Board of Selectmen and Finance Committee to develop the best way to fit all of these projects into our debt structure, providing a careful and methodical use of taxpayers' money. I have to say that as I attend my meetings with my fellow mayors and managers around this area, I am continually reminded of how amazing the people of Wakefield are. Whether you have lived here for generations or chose to move here recently, and we were lucky enough to meet a lot of new community members at the Wakefield 101 sessions we had in the spring and that we had just this last weekend, the Board of Selectmen and I certainly appreciate your input, participation, and concern. So I truly believe that this town and its citizens are special. And to paraphrase Florida Georgia Line, I'm so proud of where I came from, and damn, I love this land. And the way that I was raised up made me a better man. so together we can continue to dig some roots and show some love back to our hometown. So please stay tuned and participate as we move forward on these important projects. Now, none of these projects or continued services, for that matter, would be possible without the careful planning, forecasting, budgeting, and adhering to sound financial principles by the Board of Selectmen, Finance Committee, and especially this body. Because of the strong fiscal discipline, we are experiencing a record amount of free cash. This careful budgeting, robust free cash, along with solid new growth numbers, have allowed us to continue to address some of our long-term capital needs, as I just stated. And I know, and I hear from the community, that it's never enough, and we certainly have a long way to go. But I am heartened that discussions here in Wakefield are about moving forward, not cutting programs or capital improvements. We also continue to fund our pension and OPEB obligations, and in this current budget voted on in May, continue the agreement with the school committee, another important partner for the betterment of Wakefield, to right-size some chronically underfunded areas in our school budget. This meeting will request that the town utilize $2 million in free cash to balance the budget. A portion of this is the continuation of our commitment to the sound education of children, as I just mentioned, but also $600,000 or so represents a use of our reserves so we can actually share some of our strong financial position with the taxpayers. The Board of Selectmen has approved and the Finance Committee has recommended that we do not tax to the full 2.5% this year. The Selectmen have voted to limit the tax levy increase to 1.5%. So taxes will still increase, but the average homeowner will see $60 in savings for this fiscal year, and the average business property owner $300, as opposed to a full increase. While other communities around us are asking the taxpayers to pay more, we are actually giving back. After this town meeting, our free cash number will still be at $7 million, the high end of our financial policy, and through expected revenues and careful budgeting, we should end fiscal year 2017 in the area of $8 million in free cash, or 10% of our operating budget. Now, Mr. Moderator, I'm going to ask our superintendent, Dr. Kim Smith, to expand upon what our continued investment in education means to our students and the community.
Thank you, Mr. Mayo, for the opportunity to address the community this evening. I appreciate any opportunity to communicate what we are doing in the Wakefield Public Schools with the resources that taxpayers have provided to us and how these dollars are impacting students. With the support of an exceptional school committee over the past 4 years, the Wakefield Public Schools are on a trajectory to excellence unlike any other time in recent history. We are truly in an unprecedented time of growth as a school system. During this past 4 year period, we have seen the construction of this inconceivably beautiful 21st century school, a significant investment in early childhood education with the opening of the Doyle Early Childhood Center and the advent of tuition-free full-day kindergarten for all of Wakefield's children, a complete turnaround from an inadequate system of technology to wireless internet connectivity in every school, a device in the hands of every student in grades 3 through 12, the integration of digital tools to enhance and personalize learning in every classroom, and an operational budget to sustain and build on this capacity for years to come. New curriculum adoption to include English language arts, phonics, math, writing, computer science, engineering, and art. The right sizing of special education budget to support students with disabilities, and a stabilization fund for unexpected emergency costs. The opening of the Post Academy for our 18 to 22-year-old students to provide them with rich vocational and independent life skills training within their own community. An increase in counseling and nursing to address the needs for student support services in our schools. And improved professional learning opportunities for teachers to build and share the skills of our talented teaching corps so that we can deliver high-quality instruction for every child. And what are the outcomes for students? Well, as one example, I see the powerful outcomes of our new writing curriculum in classrooms across the district. Just a couple of years ago, I observed first grade students having difficulty composing more than just a few sentences. The difference 2 years later is remarkable. Just a few days ago, I walked into a first grade classroom, and the very first student I came upon was writing away furiously, barely noticing me. I bent over and I said, oh, so do you like writing? And the student looked up and said, I love writing. He said, take a look, I have 10 pages. And he spread them all out so I could see them all. And let me tell you, his writing was very, very good. And he said, once I start writing, I just can't stop. And I was blown away. Can you imagine where this child will be when he's in third grade, ninth grade, 12th grade? And it isn't just this one little guy. I see similar examples of improved writing across all schools at all grade levels. And perhaps most importantly, the confidence and passion for writing is present in a way that I have not seen before. So these are some of the outcomes you get with strong teaching supported with high quality curriculum. Our state assessment results came out last month. We increased the percentage of students who achieved proficient or advanced levels in both English language arts and math in every single grade, grades 3 through 8. 90% of our high school students in grade 10 scored proficient or advanced in both ELA and math. 3 of our 6 schools achieved a level 1 accountability rating this year, with the other 3 achieving a respectable level 2 rating. Of the 10 districts that the Department of Education identifies as comparable to Wakefield, only 1 district has a higher percentage of level 1 schools. And based on our participation numbers and the competitive success of our extracurricular programs, I can confidently say that the opportunities that we provide students in the arts, music, theater, and athletics are second to none. The Wakefield Public Schools were recognized in Massachusetts and nationally this past year when a district-wide team of our teachers and administrators developed an innovative tool for measuring student growth as part of the educator evaluation system. We presented our work to Commissioner Chester and the Massachusetts Board of Education, to a National Education Collaborative in Washington, D.C., and to a lead education researcher from Stanford University. In addition, recently I was invited by the Massachusetts Association of School Superintendents to present the Wakefield Public Schools vision, core values, and strategy as an exemplary model to the 35 new Massachusetts superintendents. But we can't rest now. We must stay resolutely focused on the pursuit of excellence. This year, we focus our efforts on science, studying our current curriculum and the newly released standards for science, technology, and engineering to chart a course for the future. Looking ahead, our students will graduate from this state-of-the-art 21st century middle school, and they will deserve a state-of-the-art 21st century high school. To that end, we have submitted a statement of interest to the school building authority. The need for new science labs will be a critical aspect of any facilities project that we enter to ensure the long-term accreditation of Wakefield Memorial High School by the New England Association of Schools and Colleges. We hope to capture the great community energy of the Galvanized Wakefield movement to help realize this vision. Finally, we need to find a way to reduce the cost to families for athletics, performing arts, and other fee-based extracurricular activities. These essential activities complement our academic program to create a rich, full experience for our children. I look forward to working with community leaders to lay the groundwork to meet each of these goals. In closing, I'd like to express my appreciation to school and district leaders, teachers, and parents, an extraordinary school committee, Greg Liakis, Rob Tiro, Ann Danahy, Tom Markham, Chris Callanan, Kate Morgan, and RJ Massey, Steve Mayo, the Board of Selectmen and the Finance Committee, and the devoted citizens of this community for your continued support in providing quality education for our children. Thank you.
Tonight, we will also address some other business issues. Article 3 will supplement the legal damages budget by $100,000 for the purpose of making whole some of our fellow citizens who received damages to their properties due to the water main break on Green Street last October. Insurance has denied the claims, and I and the Board of Selectmen and the Finance Committee believe that we as a family need to make this right. Article 4 represents the opportunity to add another tool in our economic development toolbox. If adopted, the Board of Selectmen can allow relief of back delinquent taxes in certain instances where environmentally contaminated commercial properties are being redeveloped. In instances like this, everyone from the banks to the current property owner to the new developer are all participating in the development. This allows the town to as well. I believe this is another important step in the revitalization of our business districts. Article 7 addresses the funding for the continuation of the program to update water meters throughout the community. And Article 9 looks toward the creation of a funding mechanism to ensure the future viability of the electronic device programs in the schools. Article 8 will be postponed in order that we can complete the feasibility study and have a real community discussion regarding the project. Now on to some of the financial aspects of the report. Because Wakefield continues to be a community where many wish to work, visit, and live, we have experienced yet another year of exceptional new growth. Last year's new growth, close to $800,000. With some new projects in the pipeline, Brightview, Hallmark Health in Greenwood, the station at Wakefield, as well as some exciting mixed-use developments in our downtown that are close to public transportation, we anticipate robust new growth numbers over the next few years. The revenue generated from the local options, meals, and hotel taxes has exceeded Massachusetts Department of Revenue expectations, with meal taxes and hotel taxes generating close to $850,000 last year. Because of the influx of these new revenues and new growth, we haven't been able to function with state aid still approximately $1 million less than in 2008. Yet, during this time, we have increased our reserves. Our free cash balance has been certified by the Department of Revenue as $9,087,561, approximately five times the amount in 2008. Free cash should remain close to $7 million for the remainder of the year. That is the recommendation of the Board of Selectmen, Finance Committee, School Committee, and myself to use a portion of it to invest in ourselves and balance the budget. While some communities around us are turning to overrides, we are prudently using our reserves while maintaining balances well within our policy level. The value of the stabilization fund currently stands at over $2.9 million, double where we were in 2008, and the OPEB balance is close to $8 million. All in all, we are fortunate to hold close to $20 million in reserves after tonight's meeting. We have also continued our commitment to our infrastructure. Last year, we appropriated over $2 million to capital improvements, as well as an additional $250,000 for new roads and sidewalks. This work, coupled with the advent of the new Galvin School, I am convinced keeps and attracts families to Wakefield, increases our tax base, and Chapter 70 state funding. Although I am pleased with these amounts, I am aware that we have a long way to go in addressing our capital needs, but we continue to address them in a consistent, methodical manner. Wakefield continues to enjoy a healthy AAA bond rating through Standard & Poor's, their highest level. This was achieved according to Standard & Poor's due to the town's very strong financial policies and practices under our financial management assessment methodology, indicating financial practices are strong, well-embedded, and likely sustainable. My sincere thanks go to John McCarthy, our town treasurer, Kevin Gill, our town accountant, Victor Santinella, our assessor, and bond counsel Peter Frazier, as well as the Board of Selectmen and Finance Committee. This rating puts us in the top 10% of demographically similar municipalities in the state, but more importantly, resulted in our receiving excellent rates on the Galvin bonds, saving us thousands of dollars in interest payments. Wish to thank the department heads, town employees, the superintendent of schools, finance committee, and especially the Board of Selectmen for their assistance and leadership this past year. So again, in accordance with the requirements of the Wakefield Home Rule Charter, I am extremely pleased to present this fiscal year 2016 report to the town of Wakefield. The report is available, and I hope you pick them up on the tables out front, and has been on the town's website for approximately 2 weeks. I'm happy to report that all town departments managed to stay with and actually expend less than their respective appropriations. Certain departments have also encumbered funds from last year's budget for ongoing project or bills, which carried over to this year. Due to the efforts of the department heads and employees, $789,849 was returned to the town last year. And accordingly, as I mentioned, the Commonwealth of Massachusetts certified our free cash at an amount of $9,087,561. Also, $462,399 was encumbered to be expended in this fiscal year. I would now like to address some of the specific areas of the report. General government. The general government portion of the budget includes the selectmen, accounting, IT, treasurer, legal, tax collector, assessor, town clerk, election registration and expenses, finance committee, conservation committee, planning board, and the Board of Appeals. General government represents 3.6% of our budget, or $2.7 million. These departments returned a total of $88,043 to the town, or 3% of their approved operating budgets. Each individual department is broken down in the report. General government also encumbered $16,200 to be used in fiscal year 2017. The main areas are some copy machine rental and cost of revaluation services with our outside vendor in the assessor's department. Protections of persons and property. This area concerns police and fire protection, building departments, sealer of weights and measures, animal control officer and parking clerk. As a group, these budgets represent 14% of our overall budget, or $10,271,578. These departments, despite a number of retirements and increased calls due to the state of the economy and the social issues out there, managed to return $39,422 to the town. The Board of Selectmen and I believe the whole community remain grateful for all the hard work of our first responders. We pray for their safety every day. Human Services. The Human Services area consists of the Council on Aging, which manages our Senior Center, the Health Department, the Recreation Department, and the Veterans Department. These departments have returned $68,200 to the town on a budget of $748,427. Public Works. The Public Works Department returned $134,174 to the town. Included in this figure is $115,756 for snow and ice operations. How great is it to be actually returning money from this account instead of going for overdrafts as we have in the last couple of years? Pray for no snow other than the mountains. DPW also encumbered $372,300 for ongoing projects. Education. The education portion of the budget includes the school department, library, and vocational school. These departments all completed the year within budget and returned $22,621 to the town and carried forward $61,889. Questions on these items should be directed to the school department. The remainder of the budget line items consist of non-department expenses, particularly in the area of insurance. The town's general insurance, Medicare, workers' compensation, and unemployment accounts all finished the year less than we expected. Again, the biggest return to the town occurred in the area of group health insurance, returning over $354,056, as the mix of specific health plans chosen by employees and retirees produced lower costs. An absolutely great job by our HR department as we work with many individuals to fit their lifestyles to the best and most cost-effective plan. As a whole, Wakefield kept the cost of health insurance premiums at an increase of 1.7% over last year. When you read and you hear about what's happening nationally, I think these numbers stack up pretty good. So kudos to Amy Benedetto-Forziati and Karen Doucette for their hard work. And I say this every year, I do not anticipate large returns like this again, but they always prove me wrong. So the pressure's on again for next year. For fiscal year 2016, the following amounts were transferred from the reserve fund. $2,510 to the legal department for materials and supplies and legal damages. $12,000 to cover the newly elected town clerk's salary, which was unbudgeted. $2,500 to the Board of Appeals to cover hearings. $5,000 for general insurance. $35,500 to cover the cost of retirement and overtime due to the minimum manning requirements of the fire department. $67,300 to DPW for materials and supplies. $55,000 for group insurance. $50,000 for upgrades to the Greenwood Fire Station, and $70,190 was returned to the town. I thank you for the opportunity to address you this evening. Mr. Moderator, this concludes my report.
Who did you quote in the beginning?
Florida Georgia Line.
Oh, okay.
Kind of a young, hip group. I know you don't get it.
Do you have the album?
Yes, I do.
Okay, cool. Is there any discussion on the motion under Article 1? Really? There being no discussion, the motion before you is that the town vote to accept a report of the fiscal year 2016 budget. All in favor? All opposed? Motion carries. Article 2, to see if the town will vote to authorize the Board of Assessors to use such free cash as may be in the Treasury or any part thereof in computing the tax rate for the fiscal period ending June 30th, 2017, or to see what the town will do about it. Mr. Mayo.
That the town authorize the Board of Assessors to use $2 million in free cash in computing the tax rate for fiscal year 2017.
Is there a second? Mr. Mayo.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. The purpose of this article is to allow $2 million of free cash to be used in setting the fiscal year 2017 tax rate. This amount is necessary to offset the budget to enable the town to be within the allowable tax levy under Proposition 2.5. As you may be aware, our submission to the State Department of Revenue reflects very conservative use of non-tax levy income. And we do this in order to be in compliance with DOR parameters, as well as carefully positioning us in light of any unexpected downturns. This conservative revenue calculations, as well as the very prudent efforts and results of our department heads in the managing of their budget, has led to a consistent growth in our reserves. In fact, as I mentioned, the Commonwealth of Massachusetts certified our free cash to be approximately $9.1 million as of July 1st, 2016. After the use of $2 million to offset this year's budget expenditures, as well as money set for the other articles heard tonight, assuming they all pass, we will have a free cash balance of approximately $7 million. This article reflects the previous will of this body and is part of a long-range strategy adopted by the Board of Selectmen and Finance Committee and School Committee to invest some of our reserves now in order to right-size some wanting areas in our budgets, particularly the schools. I submit that we are one of the few communities that are providing enhanced services within Proposition 2.5, all the while implementing a long-term strategy to increase reserves. This year, however, we are able to place some of our reserves in your hands, in the hands of the taxpayer. Since fiscal year 2013, the Board of Selectmen have left approximately $3,000 a year in your hands. In other words, we have not taxed the maximum allowable under Proposition 2.5. This year, based upon our reserves as well as our economic forecasting, which runs through fiscal year 2025, the Board of Selectmen has elected to increase that level to approximately $600,000. Thereby only increasing the tax levy by 1.5%. The effect is that the average homeowner will pay $60 a year less in taxes, the average business $300 a year less in taxes. Taxes will not go down, but the increase will be less than if we had gone the complete 2.5%. I'm extremely proud of our ability to provide this relief, but also the fact that we are represented by a Board of Selectmen and Finance Committee that supports all our citizens. It is important to note that all the budgets that were already approved by this body will be funded. The lower taxes do not affect services already voted on. Finally, our financial policy as adopted by the Board of Selectmen and FinCom establishes a goal of maintaining free cash balances at 8% of our operating budget. At the end of this fiscal year, I expect that our free cash position will be in the $8 million range at the upper end of our policy and miles ahead of where we were in 2008. The board recommends favorable action of Article 2.
Mr. Sherman, FinCom.
Finance Committee recommends favorable action to this article.
Any discussion on the motion under Article 2? There being no discussion, the motion before you that the town authorize the Board of Assessors to use $2 million in free cash in computing the tax rate for fiscal year 2017. All in favor? All opposed? Motion carries. To see if the town will raise an appropriate or transfer from available funds, including the excess and deficiency amount, a sum of money to supplement the legal damages budget for the period of July 1st, 2016 to June 30th, 2017, or to see what the town will do about it. Mr. Mayo.
That the town transfer from free cash the amount of $100,000 to carry out the purpose of this article.
Is there a second? Mr. Mayo.
Thank you. Article 3 before you this evening represents what I would consider a community article, or it takes a village working together to continue its shared success. As many of you may recall from last year, a number of people suffered losses due to a water main break on Green Street on Columbus Day weekend of 2015. The water main that broke serviced many properties throughout town, not just Green Street. Thanks to the quick and efficient work of our DPW, the losses were not catastrophic. This body, in fact, in November of 2015, approved an article that very year to repair the roadway. Unfortunately, the damage to some of the homeowners were not so readily fixed. In fact, our towns and the individual homeowners' insurance companies denied the claims as acts of God. This is unfortunate, but a true fact of insurance coverage in the world today. Unlike when there was a national flooding disaster, there is FEMA. There was no FEMA to step in here. In this case, we, the people of Wakefield, are FEMA. The Board of Selectmen Finance Committee and I believe that in this instance, a reconsideration of the denied claims is warranted. We are not looking to create a precedent, but rather to right a wrong. We are suggesting that we place an additional $100,000 in the legal damages portion of the town council's budget, and that through his office, we verify the claims and negotiate settlements with our citizens who had previously filed claims that were denied. Again, the Board of Selectmen and Finance Committee fully support this article.
Mr. Sherman, you up on this? Yes.
The Finance Committee thought this was really a good idea. We should help out our fellow citizens and recommends we implement the intent of this article.
In the North.
Mark Luca, 359 Water Street. I'm going to vote against this article for the simple reason that I think you are setting a precedent. The rest of the town should not have to wait for something like this to happen. I had flooding because of a new condo system that was put in. My insurance didn't cover it. I had to spend $6,000 for a French drain. Do I get reimbursed? I don't think so. I believe, and I have nothing against the people that suffered these damages because I went through the same thing. I believe that you are setting a precedent and it's going to result in other people coming at other town meetings and asking for their fair share of whatever benevolence the town wants to give them. So as a result, I am voting against this article.
Any other discussion? In the North.
Muriel Campbell, 758 Main Street. I happen to be one of the property owners who suffered about $30,000 worth of damage just to the outside of my property. It doesn't include the $19,000 worth of damage the inside of my property that was flooded in my kitchen, dining room, and et cetera, with mud and dirt. I first want to encourage people to please vote in favor of this. I understand what Mr. Luca is saying. However, he did say it was a condo association. That was not public property. That happened to be, it sounded to me, to be a private situation, not a public. This was public. Water flowed for 6 hours. I have video of that. I want to thank the FinCom. I want to thank Stephen Mayo and anyone else here for considering that this is the proper thing to do. We are a family. I've lived in Wakefield 41 years. I've taught in Wakefield over 30 years. I have seen nothing but family in the town of Wakefield. And I want to preempt this with a thank you for voting in the affirmative.
In the North.
James Lapre, 241 Salem Street. I'm in favor of this. Let's face it, God didn't put the pipe in the ground that broke. These people have endured two water main breaks and have had flooding damage to the house. So I'm voting in favor of it. Thank you.
In the South.
Elizabeth Lowry, 86 Green Street. I have a question. Why are we not just taking this money out of the rainy day fund?
Well, that's what we are. We're using free cash for this.
Oh, I'm sorry. I misunderstood. Yeah. I thought you wanted to raise tax levy.
No.
Is there any accountability for the water main breakage in the first place? That is to say, this certainly was not an act of God, no matter what the insurance companies say, right?
I think it's maybe Mr. Stinson. I think it's the age of the pipe, would you say?
So the reason I ask this is I see on the back page of your report. Hang on, I gotta put my glasses on. You appropriated $400,000 to repair or to replace water mains this year in 2016, bottom of page 14, and yet it wasn't done. So if water main repair and replacement needs to be done, why are we not doing it? Why are we waiting until we burst pipes?
First of all, this was not one that's scheduled to be replaced. To replace that water main would take an extensive amount of planning and engineering to do that. This water main was tested when we, after the break, we took the section out and had it tested. It is in good shape. There are a lot of things that can cause the water break. It could be a surge, it could be when they laid the pipe back, when they did a number way back before my time, they might have put it on rock. And it's hard to tell after the water break, you can't tell. But the pipe itself is in good shape. It could have been because of the heavy traffic the street has. It wasn't built, the street wasn't built for that back in the day when the water main was put in. So there could be a number of reasons for that. And we don't know. What we do know is the pipe is in good shape.
Thank you.
Ms. South.
I think that's it. Before though, Mrs. Lowry, the second part of your question was the $400,000. That is going to be spent on different projects, and it's been encumbered to be spent. Just hasn't been, as of this, at the end of that year, just wasn't done.
In the South.
Robert Curran, 55 Forrester Road. Mr. Mayo, how many families are we talking about here, anyways?
I think we had five or six people that filed claims from 7,000 to 30,000, so they weren't all as extensive.
Yeah, because I was just wondering if 100,000 were going to cover it. If this lady had 30,000 alone, so you're talking like seven families?
Five or six.
Yeah, five or six. Yeah. All right. Thank you.
She's at the bottom of the hill.
That's right.
I think one thing to recognize is the size of the main and the location of the main. Main was located going uphill, and the size was a 16-inch water main, which is a large main. To break on the uphill side always causes more damage than if it was on a flat street, so.
Any further discussion? Motion before you that the town transfer from free cash the amount of $100,000 to carry out the purposes of this article. All in favor? All opposed? Motion carries. Article 4. I'm not going to read the whole thing. You've all got copies somewhere. See if the town will vote to accept General Laws Chapter 59, Section 59A, which would permit the town to enter into agreements with eligible persons as that term is defined in General Laws Chapter 21E, Section 2, regarding the abatement of outstanding interest, penalties, and payment of real estate tax obligation concerning sites or portions of sites from which there have been release of oil or hazardous material. And then it continues on regarding a lot of legal language involving brownfields, eligible sites, abatement agreements, each abatement agreement, and the filing of abatement agreements. Also, approval by the board and execution by the town administrator. Mr. Mayo.
That the town accept the provisions of Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 59, Section 59A, and in connection therewith adopt the general bylaw presented in this article.
Is there a second? And now Mr. Mayo will explain all this
Thank
to you.
Thank you. Article 4 before you this evening represents another attempt on our part to help entice businesses to our town. Often a piece of commercial property remains vacant. Many ask me, why? What's wrong with Wakefield? Why can't we get business to invest here? Sometimes I can give them an answer and sometimes I cannot. Honestly, often it is a lack of a landlord with vision, but sometimes there does exist a situation where we as a community can remedy. Sometimes there is a solution. In some instances, the utilization of Mass General Laws Chapter 59 could be that solution. Back in the 1980s, former gas stations and other contaminated properties started to be abandoned because the cleanup costs exceeded the value of the properties. These properties became eyesores in neighborhoods in the neighborhoods they inhabited. Towns like Wakefield were and are reluctant to take possession of these properties because they don't want to be held responsible for the cleanup. So properties languish for years, fall into disrepair, and bring down the entire neighborhood. Meanwhile, often no taxes are paid. The state legislature in 1998 passed legislation commonly called the Brownfields Act, offering loans and incentives to clean up these eyesores. Part of the act was the creation of Chapter 59, Section 59A, which grants cities and towns the authority to negotiate an agreement and abate the back taxes on contaminated commercial property. This section, if adopted, would allow the Board of Selectmen to enter into agreements with property owners to abate past due taxes. But only if the owner is attempting to clean up the hazardous waste situation on the property and the property is used for a commercial purpose. The requirements are as follows. This will cover property contaminated and zoned for commercial or industrial use. The new entity owning the property is innocent of the contamination, and that's necessary for them to be an eligible owner. So the owner of the property could not have been the one that contaminated it. An agreement is worked out with the Board of Selectmen, and it is forwarded to the Department of Revenue and the EPA. Recently, this body has adopted tax increment financing, a method of abating taxes going forward. We also adopted potential abatements for research and development companies, again, going forward. But we have no ability to abate back taxes. This law would allow the Board of Selectmen to enter an arrangement to abate the taxes and allow the new owner to concentrate on cleaning up the site, restoring the property, and returning it to the tax rolls in a greater amount. Each property will be judged independently, and abatements will be negotiated pursuant to the uniqueness of the situation. I often hear that we don't do enough for the businesses in this community. I respectfully disagree with that, and I think here is a chance to make Wakefield even more business-friendly. The Board of Selectmen and Finance Committee recommend favorable action.
Mr. Sherman.
The Finance Committee responded with a unanimous thumbs up on this article. There are some eyesores out there, and we all believe that this is an opportunity to clean up some of those. So we're urging favorable action.
Discussion on the motion before you under Article 4. In the South.
Bron Delavo, B8 Cyrus Street. I was wondering if you could answer why this came about at this time. Was there anything that precipitated?
Yes, I was actually approached by a person looking to buy a contaminated property, said that it's going to take a lot of money to clean it up, and said, you know, the town hasn't adopted that, so we looked into it and thought, hey, not a bad idea.
Can you identify any of the properties that this would apply to?
I would say that, well, you can think of a number of properties in our commercial areas. There's some on Foundry Street. If you've driven by, you've seen them. They're vacant, been vacant a long time. There is one on Albion Street that is vacant just after the Albion Cultural Exchange, or not vacant, but it is subject to quite a cleanup cost. So that's a couple that come to mind off the top of my head.
Okay, so how many people or new buyers or potential buyers have come forward and said, geez,
I've had one.
Just one?
Yep, just one.
Okay. And no others at all?
One.
Okay, thank you very much.
In the North.
James Lafferty, 241 Salem Street. Is this going to include, I know you said commercial property, other properties that people might be developing in town that have been contaminated from other building materials being left on site, not at their, or somebody else had left from town?
Well, if they are eligible and they're not responsible for it, and it is commercial, if it's just residential, no, the statute does not apply to that.
So if you buy a piece of land and putting houses on
that
it,
that does not apply to that, correct.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
In the South.
Matthew Jewett, 30 Byron Street. How much money do we have sitting in this abatement piece that we're talking about doing? Like, how much outstanding do we have?
Well, you know, I'd have to, it's on a piece of property by property basis. But what we're saying is that these are taxes that were not paid, were not collected, we never received them. So it's not that we're giving it back, we're just foregoing it. So I have one particular case where it's $30,000.
Okay.
Could have one, and I haven't looked at all of them. Like I said, we'd have to look at each one.
But on that one, we're talking about $30,000.
Yes.
Thank you.
In the North.
Hi, my name is Stefan Chase from 31 Emerson Street. Just curious, just to verify that he had the correct question, but do you know the total value of the back taxes that are owed on the properties in question?
The one that I've looked at, the one that we have been approached on, is $30,000.
And there's no alternative means of collecting those taxes, those back taxes?
Well, there's no one to collect them against right now. And, you know, the town could take the property and take possession of it, but then we would own the cleanup problem, and that's not what we want to do. So I think our feeling would be, let's work with the buyer, let's negotiate something. They will put in, you know, a number of units in there, and then all of a sudden we'll be getting, you know, $40,000-$50,000 a year in taxes going forward.
Okay, and do you know the actual cost to remediate the site?
No, I do not, but my understanding is that, because we haven't even got to that point yet, my understanding is that it is more than the property is assessed for, so about $500,000.
Okay, thank you.
Any further discussion? No further discussion. The motion before you, Article 4, that the town accept the provisions of Massachusetts General Law, Chapter 59, Section 59A, and in connection therewith, adopt the general bylaws presented to this article. All in favor? All opposed? Motion carries. Article 5. See if the town will hear and act upon a report of the Board of Selectmen to lay out a town way in substantially the same location as the private way described below, Nazareth Road, from its intersection with the sideline of Winthrop Drive, as set forth. Or to see what the town will do about it. Mr. Stinson.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. That the town vote to authorize the Board of Selectmen to accept by grant or deed or take by eminent domain proceedings rights, permanent easements necessary for the reconstruction and maintenance of Nazareth Road as a public way described in Article 5, and to provide therefore that the town raise and appropriate from tax levy the sum of $1.
Is there a second? Mr. Stinson.
The purpose of this article is to accept Nazareth Road as a public way. Public Works has inspected the road and found it to be in accordance with the town's regulations at the time of construction. Approximately 8 years ago, the town instituted a proactive program that brings forward to town meeting roadways that, at the time of construction, meet public way standards and are in good condition and do not require the DPW to expend funds in the immediate future. Previous to this proactive approach, it was the responsibility of the residents to petition the town for public way acceptance. The new proactive approach also helps boost the town's Chapter 90 funding from the state. We therefore recommend street acceptance for Nazareth Road.
Mr. Spaulding here. Planning Board.
The Planning Board recommends favorable action.
Any discussion on the motion before you under Article 5? This will require a two-thirds vote, Mr. Mullen. All in favor? All opposed? Anybody opposed? No one is opposed. Mr. Mullen, that is unanimous. A motion carries. Article 6, to see if the town will hear and act upon a report of the Board of Selectmen to lay out a town way in substantially the same location as the private way discussed below. Winship Drive extension from its intersection at the end of the pre-existing Winship Drive public cul-de-sac as described further in the article. Mr. Stinson.
That the town authorize the Board of Selectmen to accept by grant or deed or to take by eminent domain proceedings rights and permanent easements necessary for the reconstruction and maintenance of Winship Drive extension as public ways described in Article 6, and to provide, therefore, that the town raise and appropriate from tax levy the sum of $1.
Second. Mr. Stinson.
Again, the purpose of this article is to accept a new section of Winship Drive, known as Winship Drive Extension, as a public way. Public Works has inspected the road and found it to be in accordance with the town's regulations at the time of construction. Again, 8 years ago, we implemented the program. The road's in great condition. And we recommend a favorable action on this article.
Mr. Spaulding.
Planning Board recommends favorable action.
Discussion on the Winthrop Drive article. Winship Drive. There being no discussion, the motion before you that the town vote to authorize the Board of Selectmen to accept by grant or deed or take by eminent domain proceedings, rights, and permanent easements necessary for the reconstruction and maintenance of Winship Drive extension as a public way described in Article 6, and to provide thereof that the town raise an appropriate $1 from the tax levy. All in favor? All opposed? No one is opposed? Motion carries by unanimously, Mr. Mullen. Article 7, to see if the town will vote to raise an appropriate or transfer from available funds a sufficient sum of money for the replacement and installation of water meters, and whether the appropriation shall be raised by borrowing or otherwise, or to see what the town will do about it. Mr. Stinson.
That the town appropriate the sum of $376,737 for the purpose of purchasing and installing water meters, including remote water meter reading devices and associated equipment, and other costs incidental or related thereto, and to raise this appropriation from the appropriation, the treasurer, with the approval of the Board of Selectmen, is authorized to borrow the said sum under and pursuant to General Laws, Chapter 44, Section 8-7A of the General Laws, or any other enabling authority, which may include Local Water System Assistance Program of the Massachusetts Water Resources Authority, and to issue bonds or notes of the town therefore.
Second. Mr. Stinson.
This article is requesting $376,737 for the upgrade and modernization of the town's water meter and reading system. The current reading system and majority of meters were installed in 1986. Both systems are outdated and impacting the reading and billing component of our operation. In 2011, the DPW began the replacement of meters and outside reading devices. Since the program began, the installation of the devices has been performed by the DPW Water Division. The implementation went smoothly through the fall of 2013. The winter season of 2013-14 and 2014-15 and a number of major water breaks required us to put a hold on the implementation of the program. Since June of 2016, the DPW has refocused our efforts on the installation of the meters and reading devices with in-house staff. However, in order to expedite the completion of the program, we are looking to utilize an interest-free loan program from the MWRA to fund contractual installation of meters and reading devices. This will be in addition to the installation by DPW staff. Completing this program will eliminate many of the issues encountered with old outside reading equipment and will allow us to provide residents with bills on a regular 90-day basis. Currently, the readings may be lower or higher than 90 days, which results in billings that are accurate but much lower or higher than expected. Consumption and dollars billed is correct. However, the quarterly fluctuation provides for a number of budgeting issues for residents and businesses. The system being installed improves accuracy, reduces operating costs, and ensures that we obtain actual readings. By funding the remainder of this project in full, we will expedite the completion of the project and be able to take full advantage of the benefits of the new system. Further, the funding of this project will not impact the water and sewer rates, as the maturing debt funded for this project is built into the current rate and will be used to pay off the borrowing. It is recommended that $376,737 be borrowed for the purpose of this article. So you'll know the MWRA loan program is a 10-year program. Again, it is interest-free, so we do not pay any interest on that. And this will let us expedite get rid of the remaining meters that we have to take care of.
Mr. Sherman?
The Finance Committee feels this is a no-brainer and responded with 12 yes votes and 0 no votes. One of the things Mr. Stinson did not discuss is that typically water meters run slow, and so you may have a situation where some water meters are not giving us accurate readings, and the water department is actually hurt in those situations. So for us, we felt that this project would actually pay for itself over a few years. So we urge everybody to vote in favor. Thank you.
Wow, you know a lot about a lot of stuff. You really do. Any discussion on the water meters in the north?
Yes, I think it's long overdue that the town need the water meters upgraded, but will this take care of everybody's meter, or is it just going to be finishing what's been done already? Is it all going to be compatible for everybody in town to have a new meter and no more problems with being read?
First of all, the meters aren't causing the problem of being read. That's one thing. It's not replacing all the meters. It was a decision back in 2010 that we would replace meters that are 7 to 8 years or older. So anything that was new then, they were in good shape. We didn't need to replace those, so we're not replacing those. What we are replacing are all the outside devices which read, or the meter transmits to the outside device the reading. The outside devices that are on homes are 30 years old, and they tend not to work after 30 years like any electronic device. It is not a reading, it is a transmission from the meter to that device. So we will be replacing all of those.
In the south.
Brahman Delaval, Sarah Street. Just so that I'm clear, this is not for replacing the actual water meter?
No, there will be some. This is for installation. We have the funding for the meters and the devices. So we will be replacing as we go the remaining meters that are older than 8 years, and we will be replacing the remaining outside device that takes the transmission from the meter.
Can you tell me approximately how many have been replaced so far?
We have 8,500 meters approximately. We have replaced, where'd it go here, right here, 5,342 meters. We have installed 3,000 outside devices that take the transmission. So we have approximately 5,000, a little less than 5,000 on the outside device, and approximately 3,000 meters that we have to do.
Okay, so basically this is hiring a firm to assist the town?
Correct.
Okay.
Yeah, we'll continue to install meters ourselves.
Okay, so how long would it take without that outside firm? How long would it take the town to just continue its work and do this?
We do about 10 meters a day. So we're able to do maybe 50 meters a week. Holidays obviously impact that. Other things that impact that, though, is a water break comes, or we DEP regulation requirements that we have to take care of. That just shuts that whole program down. So that, with the outside firm, we'll be able to keep going even when we have to stop for those things. Winter storm comes, everybody in the DPW plows, so there are no meters being replaced.
Okay, so can you just give me a ballpark idea of how much it would cost to finish the work if just the town did it, as opposed to how much it would cost to hire an outside firm to help the town finish the project?
I think the biggest thing is we do not have the staff in-house to finish the project. So the question is, how long would it take to do that project?
Okay, so how long would it take?
I might be retired by then. So, and with the outside firm, we should be able to bang out the remainder of them in about a year.
And do you have an idea of how many personnel, how many people would be hired to assist the town in this?
We'll put it out to bid, and different companies that do this will bid on it.
Okay,
so I can't say how many they'll use, but we'll put stipulations in there. We want it completed by certain dates.
Okay, so I'm sorry. Again, can you tell me about how long it would take to finish the project with the hired firm?
We want to have it done within a year.
1 year?
Yes.
Okay, thanks very much. Okay.
Any further discussion on the motion under Article 7? There being no discussion, the motion before you that the town appropriate the sum of $376,736 for the purposes of purchasing and installing water meters as discussed by Mr. Stinson. Yes, I know it's two-thirds. Thank you, boys. Yeah, and to borrow the money. This is a two-thirds vote. All in favor? All opposed? Is anyone opposed? No, the motion carries unanimously, Mr. Mullen. Before we go on to the next one, I just want to acknowledge up in the back there is the Wakefield Boy Scout Troop who are working on their Civics Merit Badge. This has happened a couple years. I met with them beforehand, and this was a particularly bright and vibrant group. Seriously, they came prepared. They had lots of really good questions, some very interesting questions. In fact, we moved from town meeting to the state ballot questions. So I just want to point out, you know, they're a great group, and it's Mark Sheffro runs this project every year, and these guys were particularly good, so, and very interested in what was happening here tonight. I'm sorry we don't have any juicy stuff, you know, people yelling and screaming at each other, and kind of a boring night, to tell you the truth. Although, Mr. Selectman Glynn, we won't have to drive around looking for an open bar at the rate we're going. All right. Article 8. We've done that. Where are we going? Article 8, to see if the town will vote to raise and appropriate or borrow or transfer from available funds a sum of money to be expended under the direction of the Permanent Building Committee for the possible repair and or renovation of or addition to the Walton School building at 18 Davidson Road, and to authorize the town to apply for and expend without further appropriation available grants from any source for the same purpose or to see what the town will do about it. Hey, Boy Scouts, I was just kidding about that. So anyway, Mr. Mayo.
I, for one, am going right home. So move indefinite postponement.
Is there a second? Is there any discussion on indefinite postponement? In the South.
Stephen Tulloch, Fairmount Ave. I was just wondering if we have a sense of when we might expect the current process to be completed and reported back to the people. Thank
you. Mr. Mayo.
I see Mr. Bertrand from the Permanent Building Committee
Bertrand.
Coming up. So.
Thank you. Joe Bertrand, 7 Shumway Circle, Chairman of the Permanent Building Committee. The Building Committee has already hired an architect and have had several meetings with the school officials as well as the principal and teachers at the school. Unfortunately, we were not sufficiently well-versed in all the options at this time, I think the best way to put it. So we are going to continue to study, and we hopefully will have the options available and ready by the spring town meeting. Thank you.
Any other discussion? In the South.
Andy Bray, 3 Highland Ave. I just want to say that I've had the privilege of sitting in on some of these discussions, and things are progressing. I just want to reiterate something that I said at last town meeting, and that is that there's a great urgency for this project to move ahead as quickly as possible. You know, on behalf of the Walton community, we're continuing to deal with the space issues there. The notion of having another year go by where we don't have a solution in place is pretty troubling to the folks back in that community. So I look forward to talking about this again in May. Thanks.
Any further discussion? The motion before you is for indefinite postponement. All in favor? All opposed? Motion carries. Article 9, to see if the town will vote to authorize and establish a revolving fund pursuant to General Laws, Chapter 44, Section 53A½, to be spent by the school department, limited to $50,000 without further appropriation during the balance of the fiscal year 2017, to pay expenses related to the maintenance, repair, or replacement of electronic devices loaned to the students by said department, said funds to be credited with all payments made on or behalf of the students in connection with such maintenance, repair, and replacement during the fiscal year 2017, or to see what the town will do about it. Superintendent Smith.
That the town authorize the establishment of a revolving fund pursuant to General Law Chapter 44, Section 53E1/2, to be spent by the school department, limited to $50,000 without further appropriation during the balance of the fiscal year 2017, to pay expenses related to the maintenance, repair, and replacement of electronic devices loaned to the students by the said department, said fund to be credited with all payments made by or on behalf of students in connection with such maintenance, repair, and replacement during fiscal year 2017.
Is there a second?
As I mentioned earlier this evening, the use of instructional technology is now the norm in classrooms across the district. All 1,600 students in grades 3-8 have one-to-one access to a Chromebook provided by their schools. The school department recently drafted a device sustainability plan to prepare for the ongoing maintenance, repair, and replacement of devices loaned to students. As part of this plan, parents can participate in an optional damage and maintenance waiver program. This option applies to parents of students in grades 6-8, where students become individually responsible for their devices. The damage and maintenance waiver program protects parents from incurring full repair or replacement costs in the event that the device is damaged while in the care of their child. The device sustainability plan was presented to and approved by the school committee in September. This evening, we seek authorization to establish a revolving fund that the school department will use to deposit money from the waiver program and pay expenses related to the maintenance, repair, and replacement of devices loaned to students. We have a similar revolving fund that we use for lost or damaged textbooks. Attorney Mullen advises to establish a separate fund for our electronic devices. As with all revolving accounts, this revolving fund is participant funded and functions outside of the local operating budget.
Mr. Sherman.
In a unanimous decision, the Finance Committee believes that the town meeting should approve this motion.
Discussion on the motion under Article 9. In the South. And I thought we were going to go a whole meeting.
I know, sorry.
You don't really have anything to say. You're just getting up to keep your record going.
No, really, this is a real concern that I have. Laurie had one Terrace Court. I'm wondering if anything has been done yet about getting cases for these one-to-one devices, screen protectors. So we have kids you talk about in grades 6-8, kids as young as 11 who are using these computers, going through busy hallways, bumping into each other. It's very easy for a kid to just drop it by accident. I'm not seeing anything protective. They make great cases. They make great screen protectors. Are we looking into investing in anything like that to protect the technology and protect our investment?
Yes, and the technology director, Jeff Weiner, and I have been talking about screen protectors, and that is something we are looking into.
Okay, great. And cases for the outside, too, they make wonderful cases if they drop, which I'm sure they do often, that the machine won't break.
Yeah, and that's something we can look into, whether that's something that parents may want to opt to purchase on their own, or whether the school department should do that. We haven't quite sorted that out yet, but we're thinking about different ways to help protect the devices. As you know, and as you're stating, these are young kids using these devices, and they're pretty fragile, and they're expensive. So this is one of the reasons that we've set up this revolving fund opportunity.
Thank you very much.
Now, speaking of keeping streaks intact, in the South.
Sorry, gotta keep it fairly short. Daniel Lieber,
yeah,
1 Elm Street.
We'll see.
I'll try. Okay. What is the two questions? One is, what will happen to parents in other grades who have actually paid the $20 for devices that are not actually issued to them? Because I know that there are, for example, fifth grade families that have paid into the fund itself. What's going to happen for those, since you've specifically targeted towards grades 6-8?
So, Mr. Lieber, my understanding was that it is for grades 6-8, so I would have to go back and check with the principal in regard to that specific question.
Because it was asked and answered by the principal. That's the reason
okay.
why. And
so I'll look into that, but it begins in grade 6 that students are actually personally responsible for the device, and they have an identification number for the device. In grade 5, they just pick up the devices off of the cart at the beginning of class and then return them to the cart at the end of class. So they could have a different device every day.
Along these lines, what is the actual replacement cycle, what's considered to be normal wear and tear? Because part of this is, you've specifically mentioned not just repairs, but also maintenance. Maintenance would be something that would be expected to be of a normal operating expectation of someone who's getting a device at all.
So
they wouldn't have to pay for that. So I'm just trying to figure out what the replacement cycle is.
Yeah, so the device sustainability plan has a 4 to 5 year refresh cycle. So we just refreshed grade 5 this year, and that cycle will continue. So there's a plan for refreshing the devices for the students and also for teacher devices, and they're all on a 4 to 5 year cycle.
And what will happen for situations where parents have not paid the $20, what's currently a $20 fee, and if there's damage, but it's not gross negligence, it's just normal types of things that happen, such as student has it, another student, you know, knocks the device off. What's going to happen for those types of situations?
So part of this, Attorney Mullen might be able to help with this, because I asked those questions to him about mere negligence, gross negligence, and all of that. But so he might want to answer some of those questions. But in regard to what happens in schools, when something breaks, we investigate the school personnel, the administrators and teachers. We'll look into what happened. Certainly if a student, stole someone else's device or maliciously or intentionally broke another child's device, we may look at that differently than your basic negligence in regard to taking care of the device. So certainly we'll look at each incident individually, as we would with anything, and we certainly treat our students with a lot of care and respect. But in the end, the devices are expensive, and that is really the purpose of having the sustainability plan, so that a parent can pay $20 and have just that peace of mind, knowing that if something should happen to it, the school department will take care of it.
Okay, and then the final question, what is the actual cost per device that we're currently expending for new devices?
Mr. Piffling, they're running $200 to $300, depending on whether or not it has a touch screen, right? $200 to $300 a device.
Okay, thank you.
Any further discussion on the motion under Article 9? There being no further discussion, the motion before you is to see if the town will vote to authorize and establish a revolving fund pursuant to General Laws Chapter 44, Section 53E-1/2, to be spent by the school department limited to $50,000 without further appropriation during the balance of the fiscal year 2000 to carry out the purposes of this article. All in favor? All opposed? And before we make a motion here, I'd like to thank CAT again. Fabulous job. And I'd like to congratulate Clerk Sheeran on her first job. Look at the new little aprons thing on the table. Pretty cool, huh? She didn't like the other one. Bang, gone. Oh, you didn't like it? You said it looked dinky or something like that? And she has a badge, too. That's so cool, man. Like, I could be arrested at any moment. What are you, in a big hurry? We got a lot of time to get there, brother.
No rush. Mr. Moderator, I move that we dissolve town meeting.
Is there a second? Is there any discussion? All in favor? All opposed? Thank you very much.